Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on Local Gov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments. Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
All right, if we could come to order, please. This is the, what day is it? This is the March 18th, 2019, 7 p.m. meeting of Alamance County Board of Commissioners. I am Chair Amy Scott Gailey, and all the other commissioners are here. So we are ready to get started. If Mr. Boswell, if you would please lead us in the invocation and the pledge.
I'd be glad to. Let's bow our heads. Almighty Heavenly Father, thank you so much for a beautiful day today. Lord, we come to you with sorrow in our hearts for the folks over in New Zealand. We ask your blessings to be on those that have lost so many loved ones in this act of terror. God, just be with our law enforcement here, our first responders, and protect them as they go out and protect us, the citizens of this county. Dear God, be with us tonight as we go over our agenda, and let us make the right decisions for the citizens of the county. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, next on our agenda would be public speakers. This first public speaker slot is for those who are here to speak about items which are on the agenda, but does not include anyone who's here for the public hearing on the noise ordinance. And in the book of people who are signed up to speak, I see that we have three people who are signed up to speak on things not related to the agenda. One person's written down to speak about the noise ordinance, so I'll be sure to call that name when we get to that point in the agenda. So since we don't have anybody signed up to speak on an agenda related item, I'll move forward from that, except for to remind everybody to please silence your cell phones. That would be useful and helpful. And also that we have a rule, I have a public comment policy which was adopted by the Board of Commissioners and revised earlier this year. When we get to the public comment period at the end of the meeting, there's another chance for people to speak publicly about issues that are of public interest. And so when we get to that part of the agenda, I may remind people what our public comment policy says. But we do have some rules of procedure which were adopted by the county commissioners. And it has section 7, decorum of the audience, that reminds the audience to refrain from making unsolicited comments during the meeting. During speakers from the floor or debate by the board, audience members refrain from conduct which disrupts the proceeding. And then there's some other stuff too. People who are thinking about coming to one of our meetings, if you're seeing this on video, if you would take some time to review those policies, that would be great. So since we don't have any public speakers, there's no responses from the commissioners. We do have the next item on the agenda is to approve the agenda, but I do have one thing to add to the agenda as it was circulated in anticipation of the meeting. We need to add an agenda item to Section 8, Presentations, Other Business. This would be number 8. It would be to add the item Southern Health Partner Contract for Jail Inmate Health Care, and Sheriff Johnson will be presenting that. So do we need a motion to amend the agenda as published and then a motion to approve the agenda as amended?
That'd be correct.
So moved.
Second.
So we have a motion and a second to amend the agenda as presented. Is there any discussion about that? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? And then we need a motion to approve the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second to approve the agenda as amended. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Next is the consent agenda. If everyone has had time to review the consent agenda, we could have a motion when you are ready.
Make a motion to approve consent agenda.
Second.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second to approve the consent agenda. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay. The next thing on our agenda is the public hearing. So we're going to have a public hearing to consider the Alamance County Noise Ordinance. And the way this is going to work, we're going to have a vote to open the public hearing, and then I will ask if there's anybody on this side of the room who wants to be heard regarding the noise ordinance and whether or not it should be changed. And then I'll ask, and everybody who is present gets the opportunity to come forward. And then I'll ask if anybody over here wants to be heard, and then we'll go to the overflow room. And when you come to the lectern, if you would please state your name, maybe spell your last name, and tell us where you live. That would be useful for the clerk and keep in the minutes. So, do we have a motion to open the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to open the public hearing. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay. So, is there anybody over here who would like to be heard regarding the noise ordinance? Whether or not you think it should be changed or stay the same, suggested changes, anything like that. Anyone? Donna Pope, come on forward.
Oh, do you
want
to go first?
No, go ahead.
Are you sure?
Yes, ma'am.
Are you sure? I hate going first.
She got kicked us off.
I hesitate.
Good evening.
Good evening.
My name is Donna Poe, POE. I live on Quakenbush Road in Snow Camp, North Carolina. And I come before you, did not want to come first, but we, the citizens of Snow Camp, in relation to the No Snow Camp Mine Coalition, put up a petition. Unfortunately, it didn't get up until this morning, so I've got some numbers here. They're just really like in the last, it was actually this after late or early afternoon, the last 6 hours, we had 143 folks sign a petition for some changes that we want with the noise ordinance. So we're going to keep that up. I think that this will probably be in discussion for a little while, so we're going to keep that up, and we'll update you on that. But I'll give you a copy of what I have here as of today. So I'm just going to read some of the highlights of the petition. So this is a petition to request specific changes to the Alamance County Noise Ordinance, known officially as the Alamance County Ordinance prohibiting unreasonably loud, disturbing, and unnecessary noises. Why this petition? We are specifically approaching the residents of the Snow Camp area because, as you may know, the county has approved an initial permit to allow a crushed stone quarry to set up operations in Snow Camp. While we are still working diligently to oppose this quarry, we need to look forward, though, and consider the possibility that the quarry will receive final permitting and begin operations in the near future. This is the time to get a vital change in place for the proposed mine, as well as any future industrial activity located in an otherwise residential community. So the background on this, according to the Alamance County Noise Ordinance, as it is currently written and in force, activities regulated by the noise ordinance are required to meet very specific community standards, which are intended to protect the community from unwanted, disturbing, or noxious noises which degrade their quality of life and deprive them of their ability to peacefully enjoy their community and their property. However, industrial activity, including the proposed Snow Camp quarry, is currently exempt from the noise ordinance. Activities which are exempt from the noise ordinance are not required to meet any standards. This means that they are free to make as much noise as they want any time of day or night, and the affected residents of the community have no avenue to protest violations of their privacy or their peaceful enjoyment of their homes and property. The issue, the operators of the proposed quarry have stated their intent to operate 16 hours per day, 7 days per week, and 52 weeks per year. The proposed mining operation would be exempt from the current noise ordinance. Typical noises produced by a stone quarry that are potentially disturbing and noxious include excavators, rock crushers, screeners, washers, blasting, trucks. Under the existing ordinance, these noises will be allowed any time of day or night, on weekends, on holidays, even on Sundays during church services. So what we are asking, and what we asked the community, was for them to sign. We, the undersigned, feel that industrial activities should be held to the same standards as all other noise-producing activities within our residential communities, such as building and construction. We also recommend required physical buffers to reduce the impact of industrial noise on the neighboring residents, public facilities such as parks and schools and businesses. We are asking the commissioners that Section 714, which exempts industrial activity, be stricken from the Alamance County Noise Ordinance. Thank you. Sorry, I went over.
Thank you.
I thought we had 5 minutes.
Yeah.
Okay.
You did. So. It's 5 minutes on the time.
Because it didn't seem like five.
Okay.
Okay.
Yes, I'll
take it.
Thank you.
Sir.
All right, thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right, sir.
I think we have on here three.
I'm not sure.
It was set at three.
Okay.
How slow on the clicker are we?
Mm-hmm. Madam Chair, respected commissioners, thank you for allowing me to come tonight to appear before you to speak. I had previously contacted Mrs. Gailey. Excuse me, let me back up. My name's Gary Hicks. I live at 3475 Mine Creek Road, which is in the Lakeview Union Ridge community. I'm here tonight to speak about the noise ordinance and more specifically about unnecessary and obnoxious extended periods of time of gunfire. We have a problem. I read about it in Saxbahal, wherever the gentleman was. We've had a problem for over a year. I've tried to talk to the people who are doing it. It's an elderly lady, 15 acres adjacent to my property, whose husband died, and now her grandsons, but the grandsons are 30, 40 years old. They're coming over and turned it into a shooting range. So, Mr. Sutton, it's not a case of changing the country culture and people moving in. I've been there since 1969, which I believe calculates to 50 years. It's a case of we got people coming from the city using it for a firing range. And they started this last Saturday at 8:30 and shot to 1 o'clock continuously with semi-automatic, automatic pistol, shotgun fire, you name it, they shot it. I am a gun owner myself, believe in the Second Amendment rights, so I'm not here taking guns away from anybody. I have 30-06, I have 44 Magnums. The sound that came Saturday was way more than that. They came back Sunday. This has become, for 1 year now, almost a ritual on Saturdays and Sundays. I was woke up last Saturday morning at 7:45. They shot for 1 hour before the rain. I went over, talked to them, because my belief is, if it's your neighbor, you go over and talk to your neighbor. I haven't called the sheriff, haven't complained. I went over and talked to the sheriff. I had shoulder surgery in January, had my shoulder removed. 12 hours after I got home, laying there on the couch asleep, 3 o'clock in the afternoon, they started firing away. Well, sometimes I can get a little crazy too. So I got my coat on, made my wife carry me over there. There I was in my pajamas, and I confronted the young man. His first comment was, "This is a country. I can do what I want to do." I said, "Yes, sir, you can with certain reasonable exemptions." I read your noise ordinance. I believe the noise ordinance is adequate for this situation because of the it's unnecessary to shoot for 4, 5, 6 hours. I sight a rifle in once in a while, and I'll shoot a pistol once in a while. Nowhere like that. I mean, it's gotten really bad. 4 or 5 pickup trucks come up, and it turns into a party, is what's happening. I talked to the landowner, of course, being her grandson. She didn't take that too good, you know, because, you know, it is what it is. So I made that effort. I have not called the sheriff's department. I read in the paper where it seems like Sheriff Johnson is asking for some strengthening of the ordinance. It does not say anything about guns in the ordinance. If that's what he's wanting to do, I think that's what you need to do. Seems like the city attorney, county, since I retired city, I'm gonna say that, so give me that thing. The county attorney seems to think that it's adequate. My suggestion is if you can't come to a change in agreement or something on the ordinance, that you prosecute it, that you try one, take it to court, let the court settle that. You know, tell Sheriff Johnson to enforce it, and let's see what happens. So basically, that's why I'm here tonight. I really didn't come prepared to talk and saw it in the thing. So if you got any questions, I'd love to take them, you know. But I've got neighbors calling me, and, you know, they're trying. I could do the petition and all that. Didn't feel like it's necessary. I made the first effort of being a good neighbor, asking that person to respect the neighborhood, and it's not happening. So I think it's got to go to another step. What that step is, and I think that step depends on you guys tonight. Again, I'm not here advocating taking somebody's guns away. If you look at your ordinance, it says that you're not changing anything or taking any what constitutional rights. So anybody that's going to jump up here tonight and talk about Second Amendment's wasting his time. So with that, unless you got a question for me, I'm done.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Mr.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank
you.
All right, is there anybody else on this side of the room that'd like to be heard? Going once? Y'all sure? Okay. All right, ladies and gentlemen, on this side of the room, is there anybody who'd like to be heard? Okay, sir. I'll let you.
My name is Robert Strong. I'm a citizen of Mebane, North Carolina. I found out about this meeting about 2 o'clock in the morning, and I've been awake ever since. I worked all day today. I had no time to prepare. The only thing I happen to have on my iPad, if it's all right to play audio.
That's fine. Sure. Go ahead.
That's permissible. I'm not anti-Second Amendment. I don't own a gun, but I'm not opposed to anybody owning a gun to defend themselves or whatever they need to do. This is, I have about 20 second audios. This is when I went home tonight after work. This is the sound from my backyard. I don't know if you can all hear it. And you'll hear an owl in the middle of it too. And I found the other. This is a Saturday afternoon in my house with the same. And this is a good set. I have no objection to people firing guns, but the same as the other gentleman, when you have assault rifles that are. I live on Dotson Road. This is from Basin Road, which is a half mile away. Turn this off. And if you sat in on Woodlawn Middle School on a Saturday afternoon, you'd feel like you're in the middle of four war zones with the assault rifles, pop, 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 and they're firing hundreds of rounds. And I have attention deficit disorder. I do a lot of technical reading. I'm into stocks. I read a lot of stuff. I'm constantly reading. Most of the time, I have to get up in the middle of the night to read and pay attention. So I have attention deficit disorder with a hypersensitivity to noise. And I'm in my house, and I hear that. And most of the time, I have to wear headphones in my house to drown out the noise. And I'm not one to complain, but there's got to be a happy medium somewhere, a shooting range or something. I'm in I consider it residential. I don't consider it country. I'm Dotson Road. Everyone has about 2 acres. And obviously, I'm not a public speaker, but it frustrates me to the point where I'm ready to drive over this person's property and drive on their property, and I shouldn't have to do that. I should have the peace and quiet. And the other thing is, I had on here was an image of a bullet I have an upstairs office. An image of a bullet through my office window, and they're half a mile away from me. I'm not sure it's a bullet, but I don't know how else at 20 feet up in the air you get a hole in your window like that. So, I mean, I have the exact same sentiment as him. I mean, there's got to be a happy ground. I don't think you need to fire 300 rounds, and they're there all day long. It's the same thing, all day long. Pop, 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 and I can't go out in my yard and garden and do that kind of stuff. I'm just looking for some type of solution, a happy solution. Fire your guns when I'm at work, that's fine, but don't shoot my window. But I appreciate your time, and sorry for my lack of preparation. And
thank you.
We did fine, Mr. Strong. Thank you for coming out. All right. Anybody else on this side? Yes, ma'am, in the back.
Hello. So my name is Laura Johnson. I live on Onondaga Trail in Snow Camp.
I'm speaking today because I do not think that there should be a blanket exemption for industry in this noise ordinance because of the potential for it to create loud, disturbing, and unnecessary noise. I'd like to present a recent example. So I live in Snow Camp, and recently, it was about a mile from my property, there was major clearing of trees and property. At home, where I work every day, with my doors closed, my windows closed, I could hear the trucks, I could hear the saws, I could hear the beeping, I could hear that all day long, sun up to sundown, and they're over a mile away. It was loud, it was obtrusive, and frankly, it was really, really annoying when you're trying to do work, you're trying to live there, and it was, you know, from sun up to sundown. It went on for several weeks, but then it stopped. And so, now I'm thinking about the quarry, and I'm thinking about other industries that might come in the future, and I'm thinking about them having the ability to do that 24/7, 365, no exemptions, no anything, and they can do whatever they want to whenever they decide it's necessary. But looking at this same ordinance, if I fire off legal firework on a non-holiday during the week and I irritate somebody, I could get fined. So they can blast with dynamite at 5 a.m. if they want to, and there's nothing to say that they can't. And I can get fined for a firework. There's got to be some kind of balance, and there has to be some kind of consideration of industry versus the people who live here and what the consequences of no rules is going to be. You know, I guess my biggest question is, why do their rights matter more than the rights of the citizens? And why, as a taxpayer, am I on the bottom of the totem pole when, you know, when industry comes into our county? You know, I did a review really quickly just of local quarries around the area because I know probably a concern is business. What's the impact on business? What's the impact on all of that? Looking at over a dozen quarries around this area, their hours are 7 a.m. to 5 p.m. Monday through Friday. The one that's being proposed in Snow Camp, as Donna said, is 13, 16 hours a day, every single day, on weekends, the entire year, is what they're proposing to do. In Wake County, they've additionally limited blasting from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. Monday through Friday. So they've made it during business hours, during the week, during a time when it's not going to be obtrusive to the people who are around there. Those limits have clearly not impacted business in Wake County. They've clearly not limited the ability of industry to work in that county, but they've also protected the interests and the rights of the citizens. So I think for us to move ahead with an ordinance that has no limits and no rules is setting us up for disaster, and it's setting us up for a lot more of unintended consequences in our county as it continues to grow. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Johnson. Do you want to copy on that?
Certainly. Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else over here? Sir?
Well, first of all, I got to say I know very little about what's going on. Mostly what I know is what I read in the paper a few weeks ago. Yes, said they're going to possibly change the noise ordinance because of firearms. I've been a hunter instructor for about 30 years and taught firearms handling before that. And to get a noise ordinance, from what I read in the paper, they think about changing from 9 o'clock to 7 o'clock. You're talking about 2.5 hours before dark during the summer. I mean, that's kind of early. I would a whole lot rather be shot by a man that's practiced or defended by a person that's practiced with a firearm than having someone out there free-handing a gun that don't know how to handle it. And to handle it, I don't care who it is, you need to be out there shooting at least every 2 or 3 months at the very least to be familiar with your firearm to handle it safely. My consideration, what's important to me, I love my firearms, and I couldn't tell you what any of the people come up here and said because I couldn't hardly hear them. But the thing of it is, this is a country that allows us to have the firearms. A lot of people don't get off work till 5 or 6 o'clock. They don't have time to get out there and shoot a firearm before 7 o'clock most of the time. So you're taking away that privilege of them being able to be proficient in what they have. And I really hate to see somebody with a firearm that goes out and don't even know how to load it. And I've seen that at some of the gun ranges I've been. With the concealed carry classes, we had a guy that shot a table twice, shooting at 10 yards. He didn't hit the target twice. He needs practice. To have a noise ordinance at 7 o'clock or even earlier would really take away that possibility of that guy getting a practice. And I surely don't want to be around him when he's shooting if he don't get that opportunity. Thank you.
Sir, before you leave the microphone, could you tell us your name? We didn't get your name. Could you tell us?
My name is William Newton. I live in Snow Camp.
William Newton. Thank you, Mr. Newton.
Sorry.
No problem. Appreciate you coming out. Okay, anybody else over here who wants to be heard on the noise ordinance? Yes, ma'am.
I'm Ann Allen, and I live in Snow Camp, and I'm a transplant from Raleigh. My husband dragged me up here 20-some years ago, and it took a lot of getting used to. We lived in an old farmhouse while we built our house across the road, and the house would shake at night, and I was like, what in the heck was that? And I realized it was the last chicken truck coming from the chicken farm, and it was wintertime, so it was, you know, 5:30, it was dark, but the whole house just shook. But it wasn't every day, 24/7. It takes, when he had 7 chicken houses, it maybe took 2.5 days to clean them out. Once I got used to the house shaking and them shifting the gears on the straightaway part, I was good to go. And then, so I lived between a chicken farm and a dairy farm, and so I had to get used to the smell of silage. Well, now I love it. I'd rather have chicken poop and silage any day of the week. And I'm a city girl.
I went to Meredith.
So anyway,
I'm going to tell you something. That ain't been good.
My daddy's shaking his head like, oh, God, please make her shut up. But, okay, I lost my train of thought.
You're talking about how much you love the smell of the chicken.
Right. It sure beats Raleigh. I mean, where I grew up in Raleigh is still a county. And, you know, I had horses growing up. My brothers would go out there and shoot their shotguns and yada, yada, yada. And I was used to all that. But then as Raleigh got bigger, and it was when I was growing up in the 60s, it was a government college town. And then with RTP, it just became, you know, globs of people on top of people. And then you can have more ordnance and more. And you can't do that. You can't do that. And so, you know, and I like to shoot my firearms, too. And there's no way my husband would let me shoot 300 rounds in a day because he could just see those dollar bills going off like that, and he'd come get mine, you know what. So I'm here for both reasons. I got used to the country life of the sounds, of the smells, but with the quarry coming in, it sounds like it's going to be 24/7, 7 days a week, shifting gears, blasting. And I have 3 dogs, and one of them's a beagle and can't stand a shotgun. Imagine that, a beagle. So the little baby has to go inside and get put in a crate with the music on real loud, or she'll go like this. So I get that. When my neighbors are practicing shooting, I get it. I bring my dogs in. When we have friends come up and want to teach their grandson how to shoot, I take my dogs in the house. I accommodate people. But with in our neighbors, we all accommodate each other. There's nobody that's, thank goodness, is shooting 300 rounds on a Saturday morning, or else I'd be having a hissy fit, and you don't want that on. Mm. But so I'm here on both parts. I can see both sides of it. But with the quarry coming in, it just sounds like it's going to be too much noise all the time, and the smell. No. I guess gravel will smell, but only that is just the water intake also of what that gravel quarry is going to take. Because our well has changed so much in Snow Camp, and it's from all the building down there. We once had an awesome well, and now it's, so when that quarry comes in, it's going to be even worse. So I should have brought notes, so thank you for giving me the time.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Allen. Anybody else on this side? If not, will somebody check in the overflow room and see how many folks? We have a Morgan Siem, S-I-E-M, who had signed up to speak on the noise ordinance. I want to be sure that she gets the chance to be called up to. S-I-E-M, Morgan.
I hope I can get through this. My name's Andrew Dwayne Thurman. I live at 149 Clark Road. Noise pollution, my understanding this is 16 hours a day, 52 weeks a year. It was brought up earlier that it's, you know, it's 7 days a week is what they're going to run it. I was rabbit hunting in High Point back in March. Martin Marietta, number 13 plant, was about a half mile from it. It's a rock mine and crushing plant. Between the diesel engines and the crushers working, you couldn't even hear the dogs. 200 yards away, you couldn't even hear the dogs. We spent most of the time trying to find the dogs rather than enjoying the sounds of a good run. Not only this noise in my house, but the trucks. I live at 149 Clark Road. I'm about 1,500 to 1,800 yards from the entrance. How do I know? Certainly not by AA's maps or the county maps or anything like that. I know this because AA they put a culvert and a pipe in right up on Clark Road at the old Allen place, when in fact they were not supposed to. The pipe was below grade and is now underwater. I mean, the culvert that they put in, that wasn't supposed to be there, it's underwater. There's about 6 to 8 inches of water over top of it. So I assume AA is going to regrade that whole road frontage all the way from Norman Jackson's all the way to the creek. They're going to run the water east to the creek, and they're going to run the water left to Norman's front yard to bring that drive that they put in there up to grade, because right now you're going to be driving through water to get to it. Imagine going from about 24 cars a week or day, my house, to going to 100 or more dump trucks, and I live about 30 yards off Clark Road. I'm talking about all day, you know, Jake braking and all that. They got laws against it, but y'all know truck drivers, they got to do that jockey shift and all. Noise will be a major issue with this plan, traffic as well. These people have enough money to buy out people's houses, give them lifetime rights, pay federal fines, ride around in helicopters. I don't see why they can't afford the extra equipment to run a 12-hour day, 5.5 days a week, and give us, the people of Snow Camp, at least a half a day Saturday and a Sunday of all days, some peace and quiet. I just don't understand it. I mean, I know that big business has got to be business. Pittsburgh's going to be needing rock, and everybody needs rock. I've been living there 28 years. All I've wanted since I got out of Marine Corps is to be left alone and to be in a peaceful, quiet place. And that's not going to happen. It's just not going to happen. Vast times have no bearing on the noise versus the time. These rock crushers are fed by an automated system. They're going to blast in the mornings, and they're going to fill up these great big old hoppers. And these diesel engines and these crushers are going to run basically all night long. If you think I'm kidding, you're just waiting to see. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Thurman.
Okay.
Hi. Thank you for hearing us. Is this working? Okay. I'm Morgan Seam. I live at, on Spanish Oak Hill Road in Snow Camp. And just here to talk about the mine that's coming in and hoping that maybe the exemption could be removed from the ordinance. I moved here only like last summer because I was living in Raleigh where I was right in downtown Raleigh where the noise from the machinery was really just constant, and I lost sleep over it. I ended up just so anxious. You know, my blood pressure, my heart rate, my breathing, like it affects your health. There's studies that say how much noise can really impact your health and well-being. And so, you know, for me, that was a really real thing. And so I moved to Snow Camp for the peace and quiet, and it's helped. It's great. You know, I hear the cows and like, that's it. And the idea that someone could be blasting and stone crushing and all of that, to the extent that people are going to feel physical vibrations as well as hear constant noise, is pretty upsetting. And it's a matter of like sanity and health. So I'm hoping that y'all are going to consider that. I have a few statistics here. World Health Organization released a statement that noise pollution is a major environmental and public health burden, second only to air pollution. In 1975, there was a study conducted by Dr. Bronzeft, revealed that fifth grade students exposed to excessive noise fell 1 year behind in their reading scores. And the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency defines any noise measuring 70 decibels or more as excessive and therefore potentially harmful. So I just wanted to state that amount of noise for that many hours in a row does actually feel like harmful. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Seam. Is there anybody else in the overflow room?
Good evening. My name is James Brown. I live at Snow Camp. I wanted to talk to a little bit about the unnecessary noise ordinance with firearms. I was in the Marine Corps for 27 years, so I definitely am not afraid for people to own weapons. What bothers me is excessive shooting. Now, we have someone who lives directly behind us. He has a little 1 acre lot. We have cattle. When he starts shooting, he's got at least 3 plus different weapons. Handguns, semi-automatic, automatic. Now I have 30-06, I have 50 cal, so I know what they sound like. This guy's got more than the average bear has. And I don't mean he just goes out and target practice or sight them in. Last night, for example, shot for about an hour towards the close of the evening, just before dark. At one time, there were 20 rounds at least that I counted. This gentleman, if I can call him that, fired probably 100 plus rounds in his hour, hour and a half. He has no berm to shoot into. I cannot go back on the work on the backside of our pastures. I can't go outside because I pulled in one evening in my driveway because he lives right down the side of the pasture, and he's probably 400 or 500 yards behind the driveway. It's a straight shot. I got out of my vehicle, fing, 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 3 rounds right over my head. I know what live fire sounds like. 3 rounds over my head. Another day, my wife and I were working on one of the outside buildings. We're trying to restore some old ones. And the limbs started popping over our heads. Now, there's a lot of woods. We probably got 50 plus yards of trees behind us, behind the building that we were working on. And they were still popping. We have called sheriff's office. He's been kind enough to send deputies out. his hands are tied. Because by the time they get there, he stops shooting. And sometimes he shoots at after dark, 9, 10 o'clock at night. And as one gentleman said earlier this evening, sometimes, especially on the weekend, you can hear him. He's got a couple of guys out there. They're having a party. And they're shooting. They're laughing. Now they're 500 yards away, and I can hear them laughing and the music. And bam, 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 bam. And then boom, boom, boom. We are literally held hostage on about 70 acres of our land. We can't go outside for fear of the rounds coming towards us. Like I said, the cattle are back there. I was in my upstairs office one day, which I can see back towards where he lives. Bam, 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 bam. All of a sudden, there's about 75, 100 head of cattle are right there in front of where you're shooting. Stampede, run all over the place. Terry's hands are tied. You need to do something about the excessive shooting. I think 7 o'clock is fine. If somebody needs to practice to shoot a weapon, they need to go to a gun range. An acre is not enough property to shoot up. There is a gun range in Belmont. There's a gun range about probably 3 or 4 miles away. Let them go join those places. Because the only thing that Terry's office can do is, number one, myself, my wife, Lord help, I can't take my grandchildren outside if one of them or one of us gets shot. Then it may be too late. Okay? It's like putting a stop sign up at an intersection. Somebody gets killed. Then you worry about putting up a stoplight. Not you, I'm just saying in general. Shoots one of the cows. Then we've got the proof that it was his round that did it. Okay? And the third one is, it's just ridiculous. I'll stop with those two. I think that's enough. And every one time that one of the deputies did confront the gentleman, he said, "Oh no, it's 9:30. My wife and I are getting ready to go to bed." Bull crap. So something's got to be done. I don't like being held hostage in a less than a 2,500 square foot home on 75 acres. It's just not right. You need to untie this man's hand, let him enforce and do something about it. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Thank Brown. You, Mr. Brown. Just like Dr. Gulick.
Welcome back.
That means like, what's cheers when you walk in?
Norm!
Good evening. My name is Gary Ulickney, and I reside in Snow Camp, North Carolina. I'm here to advocate for the removal of the exception in the current noise ordinance for industrial and manufacturing operations noise. I believe there's a great deal of scientific and common sense support for this change, so I will be brief. There's substantial evidence in the scientific literature that shows noise from heavy industry operations presents environmental hazards to workers and nearby residents. A recent study of open pit mining recorded sustained noise above 90 decibels with peaks at 120 decibels, which I think we heard the safe level was 70 this evening. These levels are well above noise levels considered safe, and in fact, the number one health risk for workers in mining operation is hearing loss. We find it interesting that the current ordinance puts significant restrictions on construction noise, blowers, bells, and gongs while creating an exception for industry and manufacturing. Industrial noise, especially in open pit mining, includes excavators and other heavy machinery, rock crushers and washers, blasting and constant truck loading and traffic. It seems contradictory to us to regulate these while the significantly more intrusive activity goes unregulated. For this reason, we urge the commissioners to remove industry and manufacturing noise from exceptions to the noise ordinance and to institute regulations requiring adequate noise buffers to ensure that surrounding residents, schools, churches, which in this case would abut the mine, and business are not adversely affected. In addition, we ask that the ordinance put reasonable restrictions on the hours of operation consistent with the purpose of the ordinance, which reads, and I quote, "The purpose of this ordinance is to prohibit noise disturbances or unreasonably loud noise in order to secure and promote the public health, comfort, convenience, safety, welfare, and prosperity of the citizens of Alamance County." On one final note, I personally found it interesting that in their recent air quality permit application, Alamance Aggregates list their hours of operation as 16 hours per day, 7 days a week, and 52 weeks per year. Early in this process, I had a phone conversation with Chad Thread, who signed the state permit about the proposed mine. When I asked about noise, he assured me that he wouldn't notice anything and that they would only be open from around 7 a.m. to 6 p.m. with no weekends. This is just another example of why this community has no trust that this company will follow regulations to protect our community, and we hope the county commissioners will act on that. Thank you. Good evening.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Next.
Good evening. Happy Good evening. To see you guys again. My name is Jason Dowdle. I live in Snow Camp, and last name is spelled D-O-W-D-L-E. So first I want to thank the commissioners for calling the hearing and offering the public and giving myself a chance to weigh in. I have two things I want to talk about. One is more general and one's more specific. The general one first. I live in the country in a fairly rural area. It's not densely populated. However, I do have neighbors, some of them fairly close, and I'm on good terms with all my neighbors because they're all good folks. I like living in the country. I like sitting on my porch at the end of the day listening to the birds and the insects and the occasional gunfire. And there is occasionally gunfire, but I'm fortunate enough to where it's not bothersome where I live, so I'm not really commenting about that issue. But there's tractors and trucks and other vehicles and occasional loud music, and all that's pretty much okay. I'm pretty much okay with people being able to do what they want to do on their property. That's kind of why we live out there. However, I think that there's times and places for certain activities where it's better than other times. For example, target practice at 2 in the afternoon seems kind of okay, but target practice at 2 a.m., kind of a different story. Same with tuning up your motorcycle. 4 o'clock on Saturday afternoon, sounds great to me. 4 o'clock on Sunday morning, not so much. So the point I'm making is that the current noise ordinance offers very little in the form of specific guidelines concerning time of day for most activities. So I'm recommending that the ordinance be modified to include more specific guidelines about times when rules are looser and times when rules are tighter. I would recommend something that I've seen in some other noise ordinances where the day is broken into two periods, where you've got, say, part of the day, say 7 a.m. to 9 p.m., where you have a looser set of rules, and then 9 p.m. to 7 a.m., and we can call it quiet hours, with different rules, where things that are permitted during the daytime are not permitted during the nighttime. So that's one suggestion. The second one is more specific, and here I'll continue on the refrain you've been hearing from some of the other folks. My little community of Snow Camp is facing the threat of having a crushed stone quarry literally dropped right in the middle of it. So there's a lot of reasons why this shouldn't be allowed to happen, which we won't go into here. However, one really big issue is the amount of noise a quarry makes. There's blasting, of course, and huge excavators which scoop up the rubble and dump it into giant trucks. And those trucks then haul the rock and dump it into the crushers, which are giant machines that grind and sift the stone, and other trucks which haul that crushed stone out of the operation and onto the little county roads, belching fumes and bellowing exhaust. In the best of times, a quarry is not a pleasant thing to have as a neighbor. As currently written, the Alamance County Noise Ordinance includes an exception for industrial noise. What this means, as you've heard others say, is that the quarry can run all day, all night, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, and no one has any avenue to complain. They're exempt. So this to me just seems backwards, that my neighbor's dirt bike or my stereo that might affect one or two neighbors is more tightly regulated than an industry which can absolutely ruin the peaceful enjoyment of their homes and property by literally hundreds or even thousands of people. they're not regulated. So what can we do? First, I think there have to be time limits on industrial operations that affect residential areas, even rural ones. I recommend no noise-producing operation begins before 7 a.m. or persists beyond 6 p.m., and nothing on the weekends and holidays. Most businesses find 8 to 10 hour days, 5 days a week, a sufficient amount of time to conduct their operations. And I don't think it's enough to simply limit the hours of operation for such an industry as a quarry or any other industry which makes a lot of unpleasant noise. I understand that the county's heavy industry development ordinance requires screenings, buffers, and setbacks. I recommend that the board review these requirements as to how they pertain to sound buffering and mitigation, and strengthen them to include specific decibel limits on noise and vibration that passes the property boundary, backed up by periodic measurements taken with industry standard measuring equipment, and spell out those requirements for industry in a new noise ordinance with no exemptions for industry. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Dowling. Nick?
Can I leave a copy of these?
Sure.
Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Ron Spinhoven, S-P-I-N-H-O-V-E-N, and I live on Quakenbush Road in Snow Camp. And I wanted to say first off that I just returned from New Zealand. Actually, I returned from San Francisco this morning. And we have a lot of family and friends there, and fortunately all safe. But I just wanted to thank you for mentioning that tonight. And I know that people of New Zealand have been also thankful for all the people in the world that have been keeping them in their thoughts. I wasn't planning on speaking tonight, but there was something that someone said that inspired me to say something. I have lived in a rural community for almost 30 years in California previously, and then the last five in Snow Camp. And one of the things that I just wanted to say is that people think, and it was said tonight, that okay, well, I live in the suburbs, when it's okay to do the noise in the country or in the rural areas. And if there's any place that it shouldn't be, it's in those rural areas. The sound carries enormously. It doesn't have anything to block it, and as it does in other places. And when I lived in California, we lived next to a dairy that increased in size over 20 years, from 300 cows to over 1,000. And by the time we left, they had a front loader going 20 hours a day. It woke me up at 4 o'clock in the morning when it started, and it's kept going all day long. And that was just one front loader. So can multiply that by all the machinery that, let's say, a quarry would have is going to be quite difficult to deal with for people. But I did just wanted to say, the country, you can hear things much greater than you can in the cities and suburbs. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next.
Thank you for hearing me. My name's Jay Benton. I live in the northern part of Alamance County. I work third shift. I sleep during the daytime, so I know what it's like to be woke up with gunfire. For a sensible restriction, I believe, is needed. However, I myself allow churches to come onto my property. I have roughly 25 acres, and it's sad that we have to have security teams at churches. And they come out there and practice with their weapons, They learn how to shoot, so on and so forth. My neighbors right beside of me have horses, sheep, and I respect them and I give them a call before I do that, all of my neighbors, to let them know that I'm going to allow that on my property. I can't stress the fact that we need to have respect for our neighbors. You've got to live beside your neighbors, and you need to get along. So I think a sensible noise ordinance is needed, but on the same aspect, I don't want my rights infringed upon that I can't shoot on my property. The time, as I'm hearing, I apologize, I just heard about this 2 hours ago. That's the reason I'm here. Total, no, you can't shoot on your property. I can't agree with that. A reasonable time, and it sounds like people here that have had shooting going on all day, that would drive me crazy. So I totally get both sides of the issue. Thank you for hearing me.
Thank you, Mr. Bitt. Is there anybody else in the overflow room that wants to be heard? Nope, that is all. All right, just to make sure that if anybody in this room has been inspired and wants to speak now, then we'll be hearing you. So if not, then it looks like the public hearing on the noise ordinance has come to an end, and we would be looking for a vote to close the public hearing.
I'll make a motion that we close the hearing.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to close the public hearing. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right, gentlemen, it's time to discuss what we've heard. We've had, looks like 13 speakers tonight. So before we get into it, I would like to take a second to thank Mr. Thurman and Mr. Brown, both mentioned that they were in the Marine Corps, and just to thank them for their service to their country. And we really, speaking for myself, and I'm sure y'all don't disagree, we really appreciate that. Open up to you all.
Well, I'll start. Nobody else wants to jump into it. What was it? The last time we were here, you made reference that our ordinance was similar to surrounding counties.
It is.
All right. In what aspects is anybody different other than what counties were they first?
Rockingham, Caswell, Guilford, Chatham, Randolph.
Completes our conference.
I tried to get all of Orange County as well.
Similar to ours, even Orange.
Essentially the same thing. They talk about unreasonably loud noises based on time and based on place.
Now, the reference to the sheriff's hands being tied, do you feel our ordinance has his hands tied?
Well, the sheriff and I talked about this several months ago, and he said he would like to have something in the ordinance that would set out a time period, and we discussed 10 p.m. in the evening to 7 a.m. on weekdays, no unreasonably loud noises, and 10 p.m. to 9 a.m. on weekends. That's quiet time. That's what he suggested we put in there. So I did. I put that in the ordinance, and I also said that that doesn't lock it down. If somebody starts shooting 1 minute before, it can still be unreasonably loud. If you're in a residential area, or this county being in transition, going from farm community to exploding population we have, if you're in proximity to a neighborhood, it's not a good idea to pop off a couple of magazines of a semi-automatic weapon in the evening. Just
in relation
common
to time
sense.
Frames in the other counties that you mentioned, what kind of?
Well, what I found in Guilford was they put a time frame down on playing radios, loud noises and music. Guilford's a little more ahead of the curve than Alamance. They've gone completely urban. They've got from 11 p.m. to 7 a.m. An unreasonably loud, annoying, or disturbing noise generated from stereos and radios and televisions and other sound reproduction systems. That's what they focused on. I don't think too many people are firing weapons in Guilford, although in my neighborhood in northern Guilford, you do hear them. But it's not at night. It's in weekend afternoons when they're target practicing, or if it's dove season, hunting dove, deer season, hunting deer. Those are things you can expect in the country. But when you get into a situation like what we've heard about, sounds like World War III breaking out. Now, that is unreasonable. I think that's something a deputy could drive up. Now, we had a captain, Captain Hoover, who would drive out and sit in his car and listen when he got a call. And he'd write a citation.
Is that in the ordinance now that he can do that? Sure. I mean, the original?
He can write a criminal citation.
Doesn't sound like that tied to me.
And a neighbor, the gentleman that spoke about shooting bullets through the trees, he can file a lawsuit, a private nuisance suit, to stop that foolishness before somebody gets killed or his property gets damaged. That's unbelievable. That's what I heard tonight.
Well, with that one gentleman, it said something about he thought it was a bullet hole in one of his...
2 feet from where I sit at my desk.
Well, that's unreasonable.
Yeah.
And criminal. Yeah. Can't fire into a house.
There's no perm or anything there.
Yeah. So, what I gave the board last time was based on a review of all of these surrounding ordinances and suggested several changes to it. But I think might help the sheriff. I think he agreed with me on the time periods.
What is the biggest problem, Sheriff?
Well, we go out on a call and there's no time, you know, no set times and stuff. One officer may go this week and say, well, you know, the ordinance says this, and there's no teeth in there for us to follow time after time. And by putting a time limit, as I've talked to Mr. Albright, then, you know, hey, we'd probably go out one first time, second time issue a citation, if we had a time limit. But we have a lot in the county, as some of the people testify to people, 10, 11 o'clock at night, firing off round after round after round.
I mean, other than hunting coyotes, you don't hunt at night.
And no. You don't see shooting a 30 or 40 or 50 or 100
right.
rounds.
Exactly.
If a coyote's awful fast, or you're a bad shot.
Well, coyotes are awful fast.
They are fast. Now, that is true.
Let me say, I'm a deer hunter, and some of the things I've heard tonight is scary.
Yeah.
If I would like to say that nobody should be shooting after 10 o'clock at night.
Agreed.
That's a fact.
Nobody should be shooting toward anybody's house.
That's right. Got 1 acre land, you don't need to be shooting.
Especially a high-powered rifle.
That's right.
Yeah. What about the industrial issue?
What can we do about the industrial?
Well, every April, you have a group of folks come up and want to shut the racetrack down. The racetrack is exempted. It's a business.
I don't think anybody should be exempted, especially a rock quarry.
Well,
they're going to be doing that at night. We should be able to stop that.
Well, we do have buffers requirements, and we have an operations permit. If they go through the State Mining Commission, if they get a permission to proceed, then the county issues an operation permit. But we can look at that. But
is there no way we can put time limits on some of this? I mean, I think part of it is what I'm hearing is...
Well, I'm no expert on rock quarry operation, but the one in Stokesdale doesn't run all night.
Beg your pardon?
The one in Stokesdale, the Vulcan quarry up there. So I don't know what their hours are. But I've got a friend that runs a horse farm right across 158 from Vulcan, and it doesn't seem to disturb his horses or him. He's had that farm there for probably 70 years.
So there's no limit we could put on the blasting side of that either? I mean,
well, blasting, and if it's an unreasonably loud noise. But the way they do blasting today, it's a measured a measured dose. It's not drilling a hole in a rock and sticking a stick of dynamite down with a plunger.
I think Highland Elementary had some issues with blasting.
Right. So. And we've got a quarry right over across from the development, slipped my mind, right up here on 85. Very nice development, and the rock quarry is right behind it. So we haven't, I don't think we've had any complaints. I think Mr. Sutton asked me if we'd had any complaints with that or with the water issue. Anyway, Lake McIntosh, there's a quarry right behind it.
Yeah, that's the one I'm saying. Highland had some issues in the school with from the blasting. So, yeah, there have been some issues over there.
I live about a half a mile from Lippings junkyard, and they start at 4 o'clock in the morning and go all day long. And it loading drains, train cars, right, all day long.
Well, D.H. Griffin,
I know what,
does that
what they're going through.
Yeah. But those counties that I've referred to all have zoning. I hate to say the Z word, but we're going into a period, and have been for some time, where the county is transitioning from agricultural to more industrial.
Well, yeah, as we get more dense in population, you got
it's going to be a recurring problem. And the way the ordinance is written now, you're spreading the joy all over the county. If you can meet the spacing requirements, you can just about do anything. If you've got enough money to buy enough land and put your operation on it.
I think the last gentleman spoke, and what he said is basically respect. A lot of this boils down to respect your neighbor. No, you can't legislate everything. You can't make rules against everything, but do unto others as you would like to be done to. I've always believed in that and still do, and I think it works, and I think a lot of people stay out of trouble if they, like Gary addressing his neighbor and trying to talk reasonably to him, you know. I understand how frustrating that can be, though.
Kind of a point. Your gun range up at Level Cross, what hours are you going to have up there?
If you talking about which gun range you talking about?
Training center.
Green level, you mean?
Yeah. Green level,
yeah.
That's Green level. I will be there. Night firing will be through by 9 o'clock at night. Any night firing, it's going to be, if, you know, it's supposed to be indoor range, there won't be any sounds coming out of there.
I know that over at Burlington, over that water treatment, that's within a town and country, side by side houses. They shoot all day long, the Burlington Police Department. I hear it. And, you know, I'm sure these things happen. I'm sure the complaints are valid. But the numerical, the number, you know, I drive 4,000 miles a month over in Guilford County and Randolph County. I never hear a gunshot. I mean, I hear it during hunting season. I might hear some shots out in the county, but I just don't. But I want to get back to a distinction here on the timing that you're putting in the ordinance versus the times other people have it. Not that I believe in doing everything they're doing, but Orange County, I know, had a big public hearing on this. And if anybody I thought would have been tight, it would have been them, and they walk away from it. There's too many people that want to keep doing what they're doing.
Well, a lot of them stick with the definition of reasonable and unreasonable, unreasonably loud.
Would you say that's the majority?
I would say the majority of them do that.
That's
I've read.
Support.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, yeah. But that's up to y'all.
Yeah.
Well, I think there are a few points that came to my mind. One, Mr. Albright mentioned people going dove or deer hunting, and we haven't heard anybody complain tonight about actual hunting. All the complaints, all the concerns have been related either to target practice or to concerns about heavy industrial noise pollution. And then we've heard that other counties have ordinances that have quiet hours and stuff, but as I understand it from reading the news, like Mr. Sutton mentioned, they still have problems. They just because you have the time set aside, that doesn't seem to make the situation completely go away. It's not a cure-all. And then who has mentioned that if people are shooting toward houses and the trees over Mr. Brown talked about having the tree shot over his head, then you have a private nuisance lawsuit. I think this is our opportunity as a local governing unit to try to address people's concerns so they don't have to file a lawsuit. Because I don't think that your ability to enjoy your peace and quiet in your home should depend 100% on your ability to afford a private attorney who's and paying a filing fee with the clerk of court's office and taking your chances with, are you going to get enough evidence to convince a jury that you're in the right? And then you have to collect damages. How do you collect damages from people who are engaging in that activity? Maybe they're judgment proof. So this is our opportunity as a community to come up with some kind of way to address people's concerns, which are legitimate, you know. And it's true, people need to practice, you know. You got to practice with your weapons and know what you're doing. I sure don't want people walking around with firearms who don't know what they're doing. But it's also true that there are ranges that exist, private ranges, who are more than happy to accommodate people who are looking for practice time. So I don't know what the pleasure of the board is. We have a draft ordinance to review. I don't know if y'all want to think about this and kind of take some time to consider the public comments we've had tonight. Oh, also, I did want to mention that I did think it was we do have one of our members of the planning board is here tonight who is working on, actually two of our members of the planning board are here tonight who are working on revising the high industrial development ordinance. And it would be great for that subcommittee to consider, I think, how that ordinance could be amended to accommodate, you know, are the setback requirements enough? Are the noise barriers enough? Can we address some of the noise concerns related to heavy industrial use through the revision that's going on right now, that ordinance? I don't know if anybody has anything to say based on what I just said.
I think that's a good idea.
I do too. Just reading to item 14 under the exemptions and normal sounds associated with or customary to industrial or manufacturing operations in the normal course of business, provided that said business are operating in a lawful manner. I mean, that's pretty broad. But it doesn't, I've heard several comments tonight about some limit to the decibel level of the noise that's produced by that business. And if you don't have a way to measure it in an ordinance, you don't have any way to check to see if you actually have a violation. So I think we need to look at some specifics in the ordinance.
Specific language in there.
Yeah.
I have a question on the noise ordinance in regards to the quarry. If the quarry is approved in Raleigh, is it approved under the guidelines established when they applied, or would the new ordinance affect them?
Well, they would be under the existing ordinance when they applied for their permit.
When they applied, so it's like grandfathered in.
Yes. This board would look at the operations permit. That's step three in the process. It's a three-step process. But I haven't heard anything about the mining permit. I don't know where they stand.
So Raleigh has not got back to you?
Heard anything about the status of that.
Because I did get an email from Ms. Allen, I think it was, about some issues with the landowner is actually not the operator. Is that correct?
Issues with the landowners and the quarry?
Yeah, we had a discussion about the pipe last time being in prior and, you know, so forth on the quarry. But it's Alamance Agri isn't the landowner. It's Snow Camp Development or something like that. Let me see.
I'm not sure what the status of their. I know they bought property.
LLC owns the land.
Right. I think it's the same ownership. I can check and see. I don't know. To give you an answer tonight.
Well, when we had approached for a operations permit, do we have any language?
We certainly look at it. At that time, I think we can ask them to if they're creating unreasonably loud and disturbing noises, you can certainly regulate that under the existing ordinance.
But would that be under the noise ordinance? Would that, where would that fall?
Well, I think that, again, the issue is reasonableness. If you're running, the only business I'm familiar with is a textile mill. I used to be an attorney for a textile mill. And we had air jet looms, and we had huge compressors.
Right.
And we ran that thing 24/7, 7 days a week. And the only time we shut it down was when we repaired things, and that was the 4th of July holiday. We took 2 weeks off. And that's the way those type of industries run. That's just the way they run. It's like a locomotive. You can't quiet down a train. And they run all day and all night. But that's something the board can certainly look at. But again, the issue is, where do you put these businesses that make noise? The best place is in an area that's zoned for heavy industry. And we don't have zoning. That's a real problem. Real problem, and I think it's going to be repeated.
Well, and we end up being reflexive to what comes, not right. We don't have a set prescription what should come, we just react.
And that's not a good position to be in.
Yes.
Does anybody happen to know what the city of Graham and what's their shooting range look like?
Their noise ordinance? Or their shooting range?
Yeah, because we mentioned the question about the training center for the sheriff's department, and Mr. Mm-hmm. Sutton mentioned the city of Burlington and their shooting. Does anybody know anything about whether or not the city of Graham has an indoor or outdoor range, or what that's like?
Don't they have one on Tom Road?
They have
or something?
An outdoor range.
Yeah. Yeah.
They have an outdoor range.
But it's very well buffered and has sound walls, other measures in place to prevent sound from escaping.
I don't think you've been over at that range.
Well, we're not going to get into it. I guess I brought that on by asking if anybody knew anything about it. So I've given to understand that there are some concerns about the city of Graham's range as well. All right, so gentlemen, does anybody have a suggestion? I don't think we're prepared to vote on it.
I think we've got to do more work on it.
Would you like me to resend this to the board?
Yes.
Yes.
Please.
If we could have that resent to the board and an occasion or opportunity to reflect, then Mr. Manager, maybe we'll put this back on for our next meeting to consider discussing it further if everybody's ready.
And I would encourage anyone that feels like somebody's shooting over them to call the sheriff, because they do have some rights.
I mean, that's an assault.
Yes.
Somebody shooting you is an assault. That's a criminal offense. But you have the, you know, issues of proof. You have to prove that. So I've heard that you have to prove that beyond a reasonable doubt. And
if
criminal
you can find the bullet, pretty reasonable.
That's difficult.
Not only that, you got to prove the intent of them shooting at the individual.
Well, this is true.
Well, the actually occupied residents, if there's a hole in the window, pretty clear indication somebody shot into an occupied resident.
Yep. Mm-hmm. It's the gun owner's responsibility, and people that are responsible do the right thing with guns. That's why the gentleman teaches gun safety.
Just off the top of my head, I would think that if somebody has a hole in their window that has the appearance of being from around gunfire, and you have a neighbor with a history of shooting, then that's probable cause that there's a crime being committed and this is the person who's done it.
They need to call us.
Gotta let you know, haven't they?
That's right.
That's right.
I think a lot of people have forgotten about the little girl in Charlotte at one of the, I think it was a water park. It was hit by a round that was fired into the air about a mile away and killed, as I recall. I mean, you gotta be careful when you're shooting. I mean, Bill's a member of the Wildlife Club. I'm a member of the Wildlife Club. We shoot it in bermed areas again with a mountain as a backdrop.
Yeah.
So, and plenty of woods, right, Bill?
You say you shoot at a berm with plenty of woods.
Oh. All right, ladies and gentlemen, what we're going to do now, I think we're going to have a short recess so that the people who are here for the noise ordinance, y'all can be excused. And then we'll get back to working through our agenda. So we're in a short recess, please. All right.
I drive for a living.
Get back to work.
I hear you.
All right.
And next on our agenda, it is Child Abuse Prevention Month for 2019 is coming up. And we have a proclamation, which we have signed, and I will read the proclamation. Proclamation for Child Abuse Prevention Month of 2019. Whereas child maltreatment is a community problem, and finding solutions depends on involvement among people throughout the community. Whereas child maltreatment occurs when parents find themselves in stressful situations without community resources and unable to cope. Whereas 139,529 children were reported as abused and neglected in North Carolina, and 2,582 children reported in Alamance County from July 2017 to June 2018. Whereas 27 children were victims of child abuse homicide in North Carolina in 2016. Whereas child abuse costs the country over $124 billion each year. Whereas the majority of child maltreatment cases stem from situations and conditions that are preventable and engaged in a supportive community. Whereas the effects of child maltreatment are felt by whole communities and need to be addressed by the entire community. Whereas child maltreatment not only harms children, but also increases the likelihood of criminal behavior, substance abuse, health problems such as heart disease and obesity, and risky behaviors such as smoking. Whereas all citizens should be involved in supporting families, raising their children in safe, nurturing environments. Whereas effective child maltreatment prevention programs succeed because of partnerships created among social service agencies, schools, faith communities, civic organizations, law enforcement agencies, and the business community. Therefore, we, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, do hereby proclaim April as Child Abuse Prevention Month in Alamance County and call upon all citizens, community agencies, faith groups, medical facilities, and businesses to increase their participation in our efforts to prevent child maltreatment and strengthen the communities in which we live. Adopted this 18th day of March 2019 and signed by everybody, and Mr. Sutton's just about to sign it. So we'll pass it down there so he can do that. And we have Julie Budd from Crossroads to accept that proclamation tonight.
Thank you very much.
Julie, how you doing?
I'm good. Nice to see you. And we are doing the ring out April 1st at 12:30 at the Court Square. So we will have entertainment, and we'll be reading the proclamation again. So thank you very much.
Tori Frank needs to sign it. Or the one I'm looking at.
Okay.
We'll get Tori to sign it.
All right, and I'll let Tori off.
Shall I come around so we can get our picture and I'll present it to you? All right, we'll do that. We can do that. Take our picture. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Pam Thompson from the school board.
I get National Geographic to talk about. I'm so proud of this. Thanks, ladies.
Thank you, ladies.
Okay, now we have our annual audit presentation.
Good evening.
Hey, good evening.
On behalf of Martin Starnes and Associates, I'd like to present Alamance County's 2018 audited financial statements. Some audit highlights. The county received an unmodified opinion. This is a clean audit opinion. I'd like to thank Susan Evans for all her hard work this year, as well as the rest of the finance department, social services, health departments that we work with directly. It has been truly a pleasure to work with everyone here at Alamance County, and we appreciate the opportunity. Some information on the audit process. Once the audit is finalized, we begin planning for the next audit. That process includes a risk assessment. We contact the county and work with them directly to get our planning in place. We come on site prior to year end and perform interim procedures, which are tests of your internal controls and compliance. And then after year end, we come on site and test your final balances, final revenues and expenditures for the year. It truly is a year-round process, and we do stay in contact with the finance department throughout the year to help them and answer any questions they have as well. Looking at your general fund, revenues for 2018 were $146.9 million. This is an increase of about 1%. Expenditures were $149.1 million, an increase of about 3%. And please note, of that 3% increase, 2% of that was related to capital outlay and financing of radios. Looking at your fund balance for the general fund, total fund balance at year end was $48.7 million. This is an increase of $708,000, about a 1% increase there. Available fund balance for the general fund. The LGC uses this calculation to compare you to other units. This is calculated by total fund balance of $48.7 million, less non-spendable items of $390,000. Those were notes receivable. Less items restricted by state statute of $11.4 million. This gives you an available fund balance of $36.8 million. And this is an increase in available fund balance of $15,000.
Would you define, go back
a slide,
I apologize, the stabilization by state statute, will you define that for me?
Sure. The state statutes require, there's basically certain items that cannot be considered available, and those are typically your receivables at year end. So because at year end, you're waiting on those funds to come in, you don't have those available to spend.
But that's not the 8% thing we hear about all the time. Is that right, Brian?
No.
It's the minimum. Fund
balance. Thank you.
Your available fund balance as a percent of expenditures for the general fund was 24.7%. This means that roughly with that amount, you could cover 3 months' worth of expenditures.
That's where the 8% comes in.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah.
Three times it's suggested 8%. Because it's not mandated.
The LGC will send a letter if it gets
I realize that, but it's still suggested and not mandated. That's the definition of it.
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay. Unassigned fund balance for the general fund was $20.8 million. You had total general fund expenditures of $149.1 million. This gives you an unassigned fund balance as a percent of general fund expenditures of 14%. Please note that there is a decrease of 4% in that, and that is due to the county showing more items in assigned and committed fund balance. Your top three revenues for the general fund, you have property taxes made up for 54%. Local option sales taxes were 20%. Restricted intergovernmental revenues, your federal and state grants, 12%. And other revenues made up 14%. Property taxes totaled $79.9 million. This is an increase of about 3%. Local option sales taxes were $29.8 million, about a 6% increase there. Restricted intergovernmental revenues, federal and state grants, were $17.8 million. You will notice a large change here. There's a 27% decrease. This is due to the state requiring a change. Child care benefits were previously paid from the state to the county to the recipients. Those benefits are now directly paid from the state to the recipient. They do not run through the county. So you will see a decrease in your revenues here, and you will also see a corresponding decrease in your human services expenditures for that change. And that was statewide. Your top three expenditures for the general fund were education at 30%. Human Services at 21%, and Public Safety at 25%. Other expenditures made up 24%. Education expenditures were $45.3 million, an 8% increase there. This is due to increases in local current expense for school system and repairs and maintenance. Human Services expenditures were $31.3 million, about a 12% decrease there. That is due to the child care not being paid through the county anymore. Public safety expenditures were $37 million. This is about an 11% increase, primarily due to capital outlay with the radio equipment purchases and some vehicle purchases. And then looking at your landfill fund, your operating income was $235,000. You had investment in capital assets of $13.2 million. An unrestricted net position of $8.3 million. This gives you a total net position of $21.5 million. Now that total net position decreased $904,000, and it should be noted that that decrease is a combination of your net income of $235,000 netted with a restatement required of all units for OPEB, which I will be discussing in the next slide, and that was a $1.1 million restatement. Okay, moving on to that, OPEB is your other post-employment benefits. GASB 75 is a new reporting standard required for all governmental units. This was implemented in fiscal year 18. It did have a significant impact on your net position for governmental activities and your enterprise fund. Previously, that balance was amortized over a 30-year period. With this new reporting change, that full balance is required to be reported on your statements, which is the reason for that change. Okay, some information on your compliance piece of the audit. Major changes that took place in fiscal year 18, direct benefit payments. Payments that run from the state or federal government directly to recipients that do not run through the county are no longer reported on your schedule of federal and state awards. What that does is your total dollars have significantly decreased on that schedule. For our audit purposes, we are required to audit programs based off that total dollar amount. So in 2017, your threshold for a major program was $3 million. That threshold now, due to that change, is $750,000, which is the minimum. So that requires more compliance testing. So you're seeing additional audit procedures on compliance as a result of that reporting change. And additionally, aside from the audit, the Office of the State Auditor requires agreed upon procedures engagement completely separate from the audit for programs selected by the state auditor. This year we had that for Medicaid. Again, it's a totally separate report, totally separate engagement from the audit, but required for all counties. Looking at your history of major programs for single audit compliance, this kind of shows the trend. Compliance work is increasing for audit. So 2016, we had two major programs required to be audited. 2017, there were five. 2018, there were nine. So that work and that means significant audit hours, significant additional time, and significant work on the county's part to comply. These are federal requirements, and they all depend on those bottom line dollars. So. This concludes my presentation. Does anyone have questions?
I'm sure I do, but I don't know what it is right now. A lot of numbers there.
All right, if there are no questions, then thank you very much. We appreciate that.
Thank you for being
thank
here.
You.
Thank you. Mr. Haygood, you have a presentation of the popular annual financial report. I don't know if we just saw the unpopular one.
This is going to be very brief, I think. Good evening, commissioners. Just to follow up on Elsa's presentation about the county's audit, what you have in your packet, and we're going to be posting this online, is the Citizens Financial Report. This document takes all that information in our audit, and that very large book, and the information that Elsa just went over, and distills it into information that's easy for lay people and folks that are just interested in how the county's doing financially to digest. This is a national program that we choose to participate in. We don't have to do a simple guide to the audit, but we chose to do that starting in 16-17. We received an award from the GFOA, which is the Government Finance Officers Association, and I believe it's a good practice. I believe it's good for transparency. It's good to post on the website for the public to access. So we will take this report that you have and submit it to GFOA and hope to get another report. The financial information in this report is from the audit. I'm not going to go through it, but I suggest you can take a look and read it. There's some general information about Alamance County, some summary info. All the demographic and workforce development information in here is either from our audit or from the Chamber of Commerce. You can check out the workload data. There's a page in here, page 5, that gives you an idea of several departments, the numbers of calls they receive and the service they provide. You can see that emergency service, veteran services continue to go up in requests for service. And then you can also see in this report how our revenues have panned out, the base growth, the tax base growth, as well as our expenditures. You know, the one thing that I think I took away from the audit, and you can see in this booklet pretty clearly, is our unassigned fund balance has reduced. It's gone from $26 million to $20 million, so that's about 18% to 14%. It's a little concerning to me, but the reason it did, we went in and designated funds that were in that unassigned category that the county has designated. They were actually designated funds. I believe it was $2.9 million that we've committed to the animal shelter construction for the city of Arlington. Those were considered unassigned, but they are in fact assigned. So we designated those, and also $3.4 million from property sales that we've made over the past couple of years from Peak Property and some other capital assets that are in fact designated for capital repair. So what you see when you see that unassigned fund balance come down is really us accurately designating those funds. So while it's a little concerning, because we like to have unassigned fund balance, now we can use it for things like the animal shelter if the board chooses to do that, or other projects. It makes me feel a little more comfortable knowing that we can explain what happened to the dollars. So there's no action for this report. I just wanted to bring it to your attention. I want to take the opportunity to thank Susan, Andrea, and Michelle for putting it together and for all their hard work with the audit firm too. So.
Right. How does that affect our, when we go to get these bonds?
Well, it does.
What effect did that have, that accounting change that you made there?
Fund balance does have an effect on our rating change. I think a lot of what I've gathered from talking with our folks from Davenport also is how what's going on locally with us. So we're very fortunate in Alamance County to have a consistently growing tax base. That's an important figure that you'll see in this PAFR, that we continue to see development here. That's a good sign. So I think, Susan, I don't know if you have anything to throw in on that too, but I think it plays a role, but it's not one of the deciding or main factors.
Right. There is a percentage that the rating agencies will look at that, but what they're also looking at is our fund balance in total. And we are showing them that we are continuing to add to our fund balance at a conservative rate, not anything that is excessive. And also, by designating the funds for Peak Property as well as the animal shelter, we're also showing the rating agencies that we're preparing for the future and that we are having those funds set aside for a dedicated capital purpose.
That's right. So no action, just to let you know that it's there, let the public know that it will be on the website tomorrow.
All right.
Well, I have to admit, it was an interesting read.
Yeah, it was.
And, especially when you get into the number of calls, Sheriff. That's crazy. Numbers are going just like that.
You're telling me.
Part of the growth, though, isn't it?
Yeah, Commissioner Carter is right. If I really encourage the citizens, people to Is there a way we can put this on our website where it's easy to find, like right on the front page?
Sure. I think we could, we have like the banner that goes across the front page where we take hot topic kind of stuff and put out there for a while, so we'll do that.
That would be great, because instead of having it buried in the minutes or in the agenda packet or something.
Good idea.
One thing, and Commissioner Carter has directed the attention to the Alamance County government overview and the increasing number of calls for 911 and so forth. One thing that's interesting, in 2016, our Veterans Affairs Office served 3,800 veterans, and in 2018, we served 6,400 and some veterans. That was a huge increase just in that. So you can really see, in certain respects, the really hard work that our county employees are doing.
Yeah.
So great, thank you. All right, Sheriff, we have a discussion of a resolution in support of detention officer allowance.
Yes, ma'am. For some time, we have been having a lot of trouble in keeping and maintaining detention officers at Alamance County Sheriff's Office. A lot of it is because other areas pay much higher pay. And we talked with our detention officers and sort of did a study. And one of the biggest things that they would love to see happen is the supplement. Our sworn law enforcement officers that work on the outside has a supplement at the time of retirement that goes to 62, age 62, then it goes away. Overwhelmingly, that's what the detention officers wanted. Now, the sad thing is that over 40% of the detention officers we have now has been with the sheriff's office less than a year.
Wow.
So there won't be many getting this supplement if it's passed for some period of time. And I want y'all to know that our detention officers do an outstanding job, and they're in just as much danger as the deputies outside. Matter of fact, many times they're in much more danger because they have to go into the cell blocks where most of the most dangerous prisoners or inmates are that we have. We have recently made some great hires because people in other departments have heard. We are trying to get the supplement passed, and we have commissioners that care about the members of the Alamance County Sheriff's Department. I appreciate that very much, and the safety of their families. Recently, we attracted a captain from the Guilford County Sheriff's Office with a master's degree, minority, that had been with the Guilford County for 19 years. They left there to come to Alamance County. And we have other people that lived in Alamance County that worked in Guilford County, and when the sheriff's changed and they heard about the possibility of the supplement, has applied and been hired here. And I'm asking you commissioners to please support this, because it's going to make a big difference. We are spending a ton of money in training officers that come here and don't stay long. And this is a very, very important part of the package that I think will attract and maintain those individuals employed here.
So, Commissioner, just a few notes about the program, too, just to follow up on what the Sheriff's talking about. So we've recognized for the past couple of years that the detention officer position is one of the hardest ones we have to fill. It's been consistently in our top turnover spot in Alamance County government across all of our jobs. The Sheriff's Office, Human Resources, Legal Department, County Manager's Office, we've all worked with the Sheriff's Office and detention to try to figure out what some strategies are to try to recruit and retain high-quality detention officers. And as the Sheriff said, this is the number one number one amenity benefit that detention has made clear to us. Just to give you an idea, and what we're proposing is, in order for a detention officer to qualify for this supplement, they must serve with Alamance County government in detention for 15 years. So the officer would have to serve in our detention center, ours, for 15 consecutive years. They also must be eligible for the local government retirement system. So they have to already be eligible if they're going to retire and get the supplement too. So this is similar to the sworn officer benefit, as the sheriff mentioned. As of January 2019, there are 73 detention officers that are on staff right now that would be eligible for this benefit over the next 10 years. As the sheriff said, a great number of his folks that are in detention right now have been there for a year, just a very short amount of time. We don't project any cost to this benefit for the first 3 years. But then after the first 3 years, we believe, and this is an estimate, a projection, that we could average anywhere from $50,000 to $78,000 per year to fund this benefit. But we have also put in the language of the bill that the program has a sunset. So in 3 years, we would have the opportunity to revisit this, say, did it help us? Are we full staff? Do we have a great pool of candidates waiting to come to the Alamance County Detention Center? And if so, we could renew the benefit. If we determine in 3 years' time that it's not working the way that we'd like for it to work, then we can revisit it. We could stop it if we chose to do so. But everyone is important to note, if the benefit is implemented today, or not today, but after it goes through Raleigh, anyone that's working for the county or comes to work for the county under that arrangement, they would retain the benefit even if in 3 years the county said, this is not effective, we don't want to do this anymore. So what's happened here is Mr. Albright has worked to draft a local bill to go to Raleigh. This requires the state to give us the authority to offer this benefit for detention officers. It is for sworn but not for detention unless the state gives us authority. So what we're asking the board to consider, you have a resolution that Mr. Albright has drafted in your packet that would demonstrate the support of the Board of Commissioners for the local bill. So the request before you tonight is to consider this resolution, consider approving it in support of the local bill that's been submitted to Raleigh for the detention officer separation allowance. So
I have a question, Sheriff. How many open positions do you have as of right now?
30-some.
In the jail?
Mm-hmm.
I know, that's a tough job. Yeah. That is
oh, yeah.
a tough job.
I'm 12 hours locked inside, you doggone right it's tough.
Now, I know this will help, but where are we in comparison to, you know, Guilford County?
Oh, I'm glad you said Guilford. We, I think Guilford's about 100 and some short.
Oh,
wow. Wonder why.
as far as pay, though, right.
we're really down on pay. However, right. I will say that our county manager and finance, with bringing on some of the contracts that we've brought on, was able to give our detention officer a 3% raise from sergeant down, and that helped. You will not believe the impact that made on those detention officers. Because I'll be honest with you, over the past years, and I don't know why, but detention officers received like a deputy outside. And I got news for you. They work just as doggone hard, and it's just as important to the sheriff's office and the people of Alamance County as outside officers.
Definitely.
Well, I fully support this, and I think we do need to look at the salaries to see how we can keep these people here.
I agree.
I think this is great because we've identified there's a problem with retention of officers, and I think this was Manager Haygood's idea. This is a way to tailor a policy to address that problem. So I think that was really smart.
I'll say this. If and when it passes, you're going to see more people applying with Alamance County Sheriff's Office for detention positions.
Well, it's extremely important that we fill these shifts because this is one of our, for the officer's safety, for one. If they're working on a shift that's down several folks, it's dangerous for them. They're having to work multiple shifts because we don't have enough folks to work. It leads to workers' comp claims. I think Sherry would agree this is one of our highest worker comp claim positions for injuries that occur in the jail. So it's in the officer's best interest that we're fully staffed, and it's in the county's best interest too. So.
I agree.
It's amazing how hard you can get hit with a fist, isn't it?
And that, yes, sir, it is.
And they're actually
people
creative.
Thought I was born this ugly, but that's good.
they've actually gotten a little creative over there too, I think, haven't they?
Now, I see a couple of shanks was taken away.
Yeah.
I seen you had a couple of shanks found.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I have enough people to find that stuff too.
Yeah.
Well, we had to bring some people, I think, from the outside, along with the dogs and the detention officers. And it is very dangerous when you're understaffed and have to go into a cell block with 40 inmates.
That's right.
And you by yourself or one other officer. It's dangerous, very dangerous.
I'm going to make a motion. We approve this.
Second.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Before we vote, I just want to mention how much we appreciate Representative Dennis Riddell his willingness to work with us on getting this local bill through. Alamance County is very blessed to have an outstanding local delegation representing us in Raleigh. And they all work hard for us, and Representative Riddell's been working really hard for us on this one. So.
And thank you, Clyde, for helping put that together.
Yes.
You're welcome.
All right, so we have a motion and a second. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? All right, thank you very much.
Can I tell one real quick? This might be.
Go ahead.
Yes, Sheriff Potter. It wasn't Sheriff Johnson. Make it clear, right?
Yes, sir.
Make it clear. I was going to Kiwanis one night. I was going to Kiwanis. And I drove through Graham. And I had some time to kill. It had something to do with the jail. And I won't mention who the sheriff was. But it wasn't you.
Wasn't he? Please make it clear.
Twice, three times. And I drove and I looked up at the window. And I saw something go boop. And I thought, what was that? And I drove around the corner and I looked at it again. It was a bungee cord coming out of a window down to the ground. And they saw me and they jerked it back up. So I went into jail and I said, something going on out there. And what they've done was poked little holes in the window and they were dropping a bungee cord down with two toothbrush on the end of it, and it's pulling up stuff, drugs and whatever. And you weren't there now, but whoever was the sheriff, they really locked it down. That's a true story. I saw it.
See, what they are very, very smart. When they're
do they poke holes in the wind anymore?
Not. We usually find them if they do.
Yeah.
Well, they don't have anything to do. We get find ways to get around the system, right?
You're absolutely right.
All right, the next item on our agenda is approval of an architect for a building and the diversion.
So, Commissioners, you'll recall that we are in the process of preparing to build a new building to house Friendship Adult Day Service and the Open Door Clinic. This is a building that's going to be designed and constructed with funds from Mr. Ron Petrie, who was here several months ago and has made his donation to Alamance County. So in order to, the project is twofold. It's a new construction of a building for these two nonprofits, and it's also the renovation of the Elderly Services Building to become the new Diversion and Restoration Center. That project to be funded with money from Cardinal Innovations, as well as a donation from Mr. Petrie, too. So we've been in the process of searching for an architect to design and oversee the construction of the new building, as well as the renovation of elderly services. Mr. Petrie's donations and Cardinal Innovation funding will pay for the design and the construction and the renovations. The same firm would be used to oversee renovations and construction. And so we sent out an RFQ for an architect, which is a proposal request. We got back 10 responses, and we formed a committee to rank all those responses according to a weighted grading scale. And the Peterson Gordon firm was ranked number one. And Mr. Perry Peterson is with us this evening. He's the head and owner of the firm. And you can see in your packet that the fee that is proposed is $88,000 for the renovations of the Elderly Services Building to design that, do the design work needed for that renovation and to oversee it, as well as $168,000 for the design and the overseeing of the construction of the new building according to Mr. Petrie's desire to provide space for Friendship Adult Day and the Open Door Clinic. So I'm before you this evening to recommend that the Board of Commissioners consider and approve both of these proposals from Mr. Peterson, and I would also request authority to contract with Peterson Gordon for these services. So if you have any questions at this time, I'll be happy to try to answer them.
I know Mr. Petrie was very adamant about being involved with this process, so I guess you got your hands full there working with
this will be my third project with Mr. Petrie.
Is that right?
Yes.
He's a great gentleman, and wow.
Yes, as we've said before, we're very blessed to receive the donation from Mr. Petrie and excited about actually moving forward with the construction piece, as well as the renovation of Elderly Services for the Diversion Center.
Well, I will make a motion that we hire them to do this.
Second.
Well, we have a motion and a second to approve the selection of architects. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you. Sheriff, looks like you've got an out-of-state trip that needs approval.
Yes, ma'am. This year, two people from Alamance County will be going on the National Law Enforcement Memorial Wall in Washington, D.C. First one is met was Mr. Jared Franks, who lived in Alamance County and earlier this year was killed in an automobile accident while in pursuit of an armed robbery suspect in Greensboro. He lived in Alamance County. He will be going on the National Wall and also the local wall here. Also, Mr. Wyatt Outlaw, many, many, many years ago, was a constable. He will also be going on the National Memorial Wall and the local wall here in May. And we would like to take our honor guard, and we will be participating in some of the things going on up there. With our honor guard, we're asking to approximately 20 people, sworn officers, for permission to go out of state. We will be paying for this out of our federal drug seized assets, which is permissible by the law.
There is a second part to the trip, commissioners. The Sheriff's Department is inviting civilians to go along with the Sheriff's Department folks. That would include representatives from the city of Graham, as well as family members of the fallen officers, as well as myself and Michelle Mills, who attended this event in 2017 with the Sheriff's Department. We cannot use drug forfeiture monies to send civilians to Washington. We can't use it for this purpose. But we do have access to performance management funds, and what I'm proposing to the board is that we would be able to send 9 civilians to Washington for this trip and not use in excess of $10,000 of performance management money from the county manager's performance management fund. So the sheriff needs approval to go out of state, but he does not need the approval specific to his funding. He has the authority to do that. I'm requesting permission to for out-of-state travel to go for these civilians, to be able to pay for these civilians, myself and Michelle Mills, to go to Washington, D.C. and not use more than $10,000. If it costs less than $10,000 in performance money, we obviously just wouldn't spend it. So.
Do we need 2 motions, separate motions, or can we do all that with one motion?
I think you probably
do all
do
one
that
motion.
One, yes.
How much can we do that?
I'll second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to do that. Is there any more discussion? I'm just so tickled to death, to learn that Wyatt Outlaw's name is going to be included on those memorials. That is just
That's great.
Way overdue.
Remarkable.
We
have a motion and a second. There's no more discussion. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, the next item on our agenda is to discuss the evaluation process, the process by which we evaluate the 4 county employees who are direct reports to the board. And Sherry Hook was going to talk to us about that. It's now 9:09, and I was wondering if maybe Ms. Hook, do you have some materials for the board?
I have quite a few materials.
Do you think that you could maybe give those to the board, and then we could table the discussion until the next meeting if there's no objection from the other members of the board? So we have time. Can you tell us just a little bit about what you have there, and then we can take it and look it over and be prepared for a discussion next time?
What I'm going to give to you is a packet of quite a bit of information.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So the start of this, or the first part of this, is going to be a sample department head review form that you can use for evaluating the 4 positions. The 4 positions are county manager, attorney, tax administrator, and clerk to the board, which clerk to the board reports into the county manager, but also works closely with the board. So you guys may want to decide if you want to evaluate the clerk separately. That's your decision. So what I've given you in here is also the performance management goals for last year and also for this current year. and then the job descriptions for the four positions, and then the pinks, after the pink piece of paper, some comparisons with other counties, and some information about how the job description for clerk of the board for Alamance is a little bit different from other counties, and then lots and lots of job descriptions from other counties. So, all right.
Definitely think tabling this would be great.
Thank you. Yeah, let's have, do we have a motion to table?
I'll make a motion that we table this to future meeting.
We have a motion and a second to table this agenda item related to evaluating our board appointments. Is there any more discussion about that? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, and then at the beginning of the meeting, we had added an agenda item for the sheriff, the Southern Health Partner contract for the jail inmate health care.
Yes, ma'am. With the recent sign of contracts with ICE, there were certain requirements that they made. One of the requirements that we hire four LPNs to sit at the desk to interview any inmate coming into the Alamance County Jail for medical purposes, because HIPAA prohibits our officers from asking specific questions about health situation with the inmates being brought in. With that, an addendum to the current year contract has to be signed and in place before June. They want to start hiring by April, and this addendum has to be in place because the ICE had given the money, or is paying the money per day, per detainee, to pay for these nurses that will be working at the front desk.
So the ICE is going to pick up the tab on this?
Yes, sir.
And who will they work under? I mean,
they under Southern Health Partners. Susan Fortner is the supervisor for Southern Health Partners, housed in the jail. They do all of our medical in the jail, Southern Health Partners. And these four will be under her in the detention center. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And secondly, there is a contract. All we need is a letter that was sent to be signed, because in our original contract it said we could continue the next year by a letter with all the stuff, which we're going to be asking y'all to consider going on and allowing our county manager to sign the addendum and the letter contract to move on into the next year with Southern Health Partners. They have been very good to work with, and we'd like to keep them there if we can.
So I'm told the board action is needed to, one, approve the contract addendum for Southern Health Partners with fiscal year 2018-2019 current annual rate of $1,124,349.76. Two, approve the 3% increase for fiscal year 2019-2020, which takes the annual rate to $1,148,283.24. And three, approve that the county manager should sign the contract addendum in the March 12th, 2019 letter on behalf of the county.
Yes, and I would like to thank Clyde Albright. He took both the addendum and contract, reviewed and made numerous changes in the addendum. I submitted it to the Southern Health Partners, and they approved every change that he wanted made in there. I want to thank him for that.
So we can do all three of those things in one vote.
I'll
yes.
make a motion. We approve it.
Thank you, Mr. Carter.
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Fossil. We have a motion and a second to approve those actions. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, next on our agenda is the public speakers for the evening who are not related to an agenda item. And we have just a few people signed up. First is Ms. Mary Jo Collins, and as she comes forward, I do have remarks submitted by Ms. Ovitch, who was here last week. We're not reading all this, but I was going to pass this
take a look at that. I'm not sure that this is five separate copies. Did y'all look at copies?
Yeah, we got it.
Oh, okay, this is mine. Ms. Collins?
Well, since the bike rides had been brought up before this commission earlier this month, I want to talk about that. My name is Mary Jo Collins. I've served on two committees in Raleigh, appointed by two different governors, and I'm the recipient of the Order of the Longleaf Pine. I have served as a hospice volunteer and also ambassador for Donate Life here in Alamance County. My only child died while waiting for an organ transplant. I had a bill passed in my son's name called Duffy's Law, which makes April Organ Donation Awareness Donate Life Month for the state of North Carolina, and started the Duffy Collins Organ Transplant Foundation. The bikers in this community were the first to contact me on raising money for my charity. I have participated in many of the rides held in this county for various charitable causes, even though I don't own a bike. The bikers have raised almost $1 million in the last 10 years for various charitable causes, and the money stays here in Alamance County. Example is the Miles for Mutts, Kids Path for Hospice, Tata Run for Cancer, Duffy's Ride for Transplants, and many more. Through my ride and golf tournament, we have saved 5 lives. How do you put a price on that? I have never seen what has been portrayed here before this board as a dangerous drinking ride. I am almost 72 years old and a widow, and I can assure ye that I would not put my life on the line to engage in something I thought was dangerous or immoral. If we stop the bike riders, then we need to close down the golf courses. Golfers bring their own coolers of beverages and alcohol is served at most of the clubhouses. Most all of the fundraisers for federal, state, and locally elected officials have alcoholic beverages there because I have been to so many I've lost count. Our restaurants have bars that I have seen people sit for hours and drink. You can just not stop one without stopping all. Where does this personal vendetta end? Whether it is a party for Little Pink House or any other event, alcohol is served. As far as the bikers are concerned, on their stops, most use the bathroom, drink soft drinks or water until they get to the after party. Safe Ride is there to take you home or designate a driver. Many bikers leave their bikes locked in the gate and do not ride their bikes home. Does this county have money in their budget to support these charitable causes? I'm very proud of what is done in this county to help others. Again, how do you put a price tag on lives being saved? As far as the poker run is, my experience is that the money is almost always donated back to the charity. If you stop the bikers, you will have to stop the golfers, restaurants, and political fundraisers, and just make this a dry county. Drinking and driving is a personal choice. It is not a certain group choice. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mrs. Collins. Okay, J.S. Walker.
What I want to ask, and I ain't the brightest bulb in the pack, but I think it was a law made years ago, county landfill. Everything come in there was supposed to be tarped, tied down on all four sides. I live on the Mount Willen Road in Alamance County. I got several the neighbors back here and over here. They come through there with trash, piled as high as they can get it on a trailer, pulling with a pickup and a dump truck. No tarp on it. What I want to ask is y'all, county commissioners, to refreshing Mr. Richard Hill on the law down there, because I followed the truck down there. that scared it all over my land. Now, I got to admit one thing. He was nice after I got through losing my temper. And I did lose it. He sent a man, and he come over there and helped pick it up. He says they pick it up on Mineral Springs Road. They do not pick it up on Mount Willen Road. And they pick it up on Bethlehem Church Road. They see it. So many weeks. They bring their help over there from the landfill. They have more help on Monday, he said. But I see trucks coming through from Mebane. I have seen Graham trash trucks. I have seen Burlington trash trucks coming down 54. More trash coming out than is going in. So, you know, they need to get a hold to the managers of each one of these departments and do something about it. And that's all I ask. And I worked for the state 30 years. They took the prisoners off the road, carried them out many a time. I worked prisoners for 17 years. I ended up being road maintenance supervisor of Alamance County with Mike Mills. Y'all may know him. He's in Greensboro. Me and him worked together for years. And somebody needs to call him and tell him, since they done away with them, they hired contractors. Put them contractors on these side roads. That's how the trash gets to the landfill to come through the side roads. They've done that. And 40% of people on the Mount Willen Road, I say, is disabled and can't get out there and pick up trash. And it's getting to be worse and worse. And I have a name here, which I don't think I can mention here, of the truck kind of, who's hauling it through there. Two of them. He's got to pull in the pickup with a trailer. And but I will get with Mr. Richard Hill on that, and they ought to be able to turn them around. If they don't have a tarp on, send them back like they used to do years ago.
They can.
And I don't think that'd take y'all too long to vote on that, and Miss Scott can get a hold of Mike Mills, or I will one.
I'll see him tomorrow, sir.
You'll see him tomorrow. You asked him if he knows Steve Walker. I guarantee you he'll know me. You asked him. He's a good man. He's worked 40 years, I worked 30. But anyway, that's what I would like for y'all to do, and get a hold of the maintenance people in Burlington and Graham and let them fix their trucks. And DOT, you can get with Mike and let them send the contractors on the side roads, Mount Willen, Mineral Springs, Bethlehem Church Road,
yes, sir. Yes, sir.
All
yes,
them
sir.
Side roads.
We got you.
All right.
A minute over.
Thank you, ma'am. You can vote on that now.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Walker. We do have a rule now that we don't vote on stuff during commissioner comments and stuff like that. And then we have Mr. Dowdle written down, but he came during the noise ordinance. So I guess technically he can come again, but I think he's gone. So, all right. Do we have any responses to the public speakers?
Well, to his comment about the vehicles coming in, at one time they did. If you didn't have a tarp on, you had to turn around and go back home and get your tarp and put it on, which I don't know if that helped, but...
it helped spread the trash.
It helped spread it out. But there should be a way to do that. And actually, it's called littering.
Yeah,
and there are fines for littering. And I don't get, even if it's a city truck or whatever. So.
Well, Sheriff Johnson could help on part of this. I see deputies sitting down at Swepsonville Fire Department on 54, Alexander Wilson School, and down Old Talbert Store. So as they
yes,
say,
sir. Mr. Okay. Walker, you
that's
have
fine.
We can stop.
We make note to it.
This is the commissioner's opportunity to respond, and we're not going to have a conversation back
right.
and forth. I think that maybe Mr. Hager could check with Mr. Hill and just get a report back that they're doing what they're supposed to be doing in the landfill.
We'll also reach out to the city managers and make sure that they please touch base with their waste departments and make sure they're checking their tarps and make sure they work. So, absolutely.
in reference to his comment about the DOT and picking up trash. I serve on a board with a couple of the DOT guys, and one of them approached me about trying to arrange a contract with the sheriff to use, I guess you'd call them trustees.
Mr. Carter, we're looking at that right now.
That's a great idea.
Be up here before the commission in the very, 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 very near future.
Good. Thank you.
That's a great idea.
Anybody else have anything to say? I just have noticed that there's so much trash on the roads. I don't know if it's because it's the end of the wintertime and the mowers run during the summer, and I think chop up a lot of the trash that ends up. But yeah, making it a little trash, and then it gets in, it disappears in the grass. But it's awful. This county looks filthy. I'm sorry. There's trash everywhere. And it aggravates me, you see, so much. There's certain intersections that I won't name, but I drive past them, and they just look terrible. And Ms. Collins, thank you so much for coming out tonight. It's always good to see you.
I remember the first Duffy ride she rode in that, because I was in it. She rode my cousin, and I think she was beating him on the head to slow down, but... She was a brave one. You were a brave one, riding with bones, no doubt.
Okay, Mr. Hager, do you have a report tonight?
Just two quick items, Commissioners, just to let you know that we talked a couple of meetings ago about the land development plan, RFQ. Planning Department has completed that RFQ, that request for qualifications, and we'll be sending that out immediately. We'll let it stay out for 30 days. Get responses, select a firm that we'll recommend to the board. So I'll be coming back, or Tanya will be coming back in the next probably 4 to 6 weeks, bringing you a selection that we would recommend to update the land development plan and to put us in a position to consider some of the small area plans that we talked about when Tanya presented land use regulation options. And also to let the board know that we are, we have an request for proposals out now for audit services. It's on the website, and it's been released to all of our outlets. That RFP closes April the 12th, and we'll be planning to bring a firm to the commissioners by May the 6th to recommend that you choose to do our audit. So, you know, I think the auditor mentioned, you know, a lot of this new compliance pieces that the state is requiring is making the cost go up a little bit, so we want to see what might be out there to be a little bit more affordable, to see what's going on. So that's all that I have.
Great. And Commissioner comments, I think Mr. Carter, you have something you want to?
Yes, I do. As you may recall, about two meetings ago now, I think we approved a resolution to put the phrase "In God We Trust," it's on our over our dais and on our courthouses, on our county cars. And we, our intent was to try and do that with private funding. And quickly, Mr. Jimmy Brumley with Pitt Printing came forward and volunteered to provide those not only for the current cars, but going forward. And that's an example of the bumper stickers that will be on the rest of the county cars. There's similar ones on the sheriff's vehicles now. So he gave us 150 of these initially, which is more than enough to cover the cars we need. So I think we owe him a great round of applause or thanks or something.
I agree.
We do. Right, and thank you very much for putting all that together. Mm-hmm. That's
thank
really
you.
Outstanding.
Nice job.
Does anybody else have anything to say? Mm-hmm. If not... Well,
let me say one thing about it. I apologize for Sheriff Gary. You know, a lot of people just poo-poo this idea about, you know, that we got people trying to do things in our country that are, you know, bad, or if they're on a visa or not on a visa. You know what happened in Fort Bragg Tuesday? Did you?
No.
You had a Jordanian pull up to a gate that I've been through many times and try to enter Fort Bragg. His visa had expired. His license had expired. Everything about him had expired. And they tried to get him to say, "Why are you trying to get on base?" And all he would say was, "I want to tour the special operations unit to see if it's worth my time."
And they took him in the building over to the left where you fingerprinted and photographed and the whole nine yards, and he was in the ozone. And they took him to, he was supposed to have a federal hearing on deportation, I think. If anybody believes that guy was wanting to get on that base for any good intent, needs their head examined. And if, and that's not 60 miles away as the crow flies. And so I just hope we stay tuned to that one especially.
We're going to do our part.
Yeah.
Great. If nobody else has anything further, then we'll be adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners occur on the first and third Monday of every month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month occurs at 9 a.m. and the second meeting occurs at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on LocalGov TV. Please go to www.localgovtvnc.com for more information about this schedule and to see more videos produced by your local governments. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com or at our YouTube channel. Technical questions regarding this meeting's broadcast or production may be sent to our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. This address is for technical questions only. Comments and questions about the content of the meeting may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. There, you can click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes and agendas of commissioner meetings, and find other information about the county commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.